Hello and welcome to Star Trek Online. My name is P52 Smith, and today we are back on the Tribble test server for a couple of reasons. Firstly, in a patch release not all that long ago from time of recording, Cryptic have modified the uniform options for all players. At the moment on the holodeck, the Odyssey-style uniform, which I'm currently modelling here, is available from the Fleet Tailor to purchase for some dilithium and fleet credits. That is no longer the case here on Tribble. The Odyssey uniform is now available as standard for all Federation captains, and also for the bridge officers, I believe, of Romulan players who are allied to the Federation. Likewise, for the Klingon Defence Force, the Bortas uniform used to be available in the Fleet Tailor. That is now also standard, free available for all players of Klingon Defence Force faction and the bridge officers of Romulan allied with KDF. Along with this, Cryptic have added a few new options. We go and change my uniform into the Tailor. So we're dealing with the standard Odyssey here, with not the Odyssey belt, because there isn't an Odyssey belt on holodeck at the moment. However, we now have under here the standard Odyssey and the Odyssey Along Jacket. This is available to 200 day veteran players. So as you can see, it has a little bit more below the belt and adds some little banding to the wrists. Additionally, in the Fleet Tailor, you have the options for Odyssey Dress, which also includes the Command, Operations and Sciences variant. If I zoom in on the shoulders here and do this again, you can see we have the dress, which has that icon. We also have Command, Operations and Sciences insignia over the top of the icon. Otherwise, these are fundamentally the same, and the colour options work in the same way as for the Odyssey standard, with the extra banding all being controlled by that one option in there, and of course all the gold piping on this end one here, which you can also just stick to whatever colour you fancy it being. A little bit disappointed we don't get to change the colour of this shoulder icon separately, but we can live with that. Additionally, from the Fleet Tailor, you can also purchase the Odyssey Tactical option, which doesn't have a huge amount of difference to the Odyssey standard. This line's slightly more defined, a few additional sort of lines around there and some lines across the chest, but fundamentally the top part here is the same. However, if we come down here, under the Pants Loose Long type, we have Odyssey Trousers, and we have the Odyssey Boots. However, if we go to Tight, we now also have Odyssey Tactical Bottoms and Odyssey Tactical Boots. Remember, these are available from the Fleet Tailor. If you have already purchased the current standard Odyssey uniform from the Fleet Tailor, you'll be able to pick up the Odyssey Dress and Odyssey Tactical options completely free of charge. If you don't already own them, then each of them is available at half the price of the current Odyssey uniforms. Oops, I wanted that to be red. I will have that as red as well. This means that the cost of the new options is exactly the same as the cost of the old options. We also have some new belts. Standard Odyssey, Odyssey Dress, and Odyssey Tactical. What does it look like with none there? So there's definitely a join between the two, so we'll stick with Odyssey Tactical. Let's have those. We'll have red. Oops, wrong red. That will go black. That can go red. And the outer edge of that can go gold. So what's interesting though is how dark these actual straps are on the belt, because these are the same red colour as my shoulder pads and the bit in the middle there and all that. Now I put that as the brightest red, A12, it's still even darker. By contrast, if I put the shoulders up, the shoulders, to A12, you can see they're substantially brighter. So I'm not sure if that's an intended difference, but it's a difference nonetheless. So we will stick with that. I'm not aware of any Odyssey dress boots, but then I haven't spent much time in the dress uniform, though I doubt that would make much difference. dress there. Odyssey tactical only. I've not seen any Odyssey dress appear anywhere in any of these options. That's got no options, and that's got no options. So yeah, there's no dress trousers, which is interesting, so I'll assume they just use the standard Odyssey ones as well, with the standard Odyssey boots. But that's not the end of the world if that's the case. So, I think we will make use of the Odyssey. The big thing I like with the Odyssey long is having these extra bands on the wrist. To me, that's quite a nice touch to add. Now, a lot of people have said they wanted Admiral Quinn's uniform, and I'm pretty sure that this is what he's using. The Odyssey long and one of the Odyssey belts. Probably that one or that one. So you can have a bit of a play around the tailor once this comes to holodeck, if you have 200-day veteran status. If not, yeah, sorry. But I don't like having the belt over the top of the jacket extending below. So if I'm going to go for the long, we're going to have no belt. However, there is Odyssey Tactical, which does... No. It's still too smart in some ways. So we're going to go Odyssey Long. We're going to go no belt. And trousers. Do we want Odyssey Long? Or do we want to go for Odyssey Tactical? See, I'm not so keen on the whole massive boots thing, I much prefer shoes, so we are going to stick with Odyssey Standard. Same for the boots. And I do like having the red on the bottom. There we go. Now, I did some more fiddling around with the system quite a while after the original recording, and I found a few new things I'd missed on the first run. Firstly, under comm badges, we have an Odyssey 1 and Odyssey 2 comm badge. We can see here the Odyssey 1 is just a simple outline of the Starfleet logo. Odyssey 2 has an extra bar behind it, similar to the Voyager era comm badge. Both of them, you only have one colour you can choose. In fact, the sort of background of this one is fixed. Again, that might be an unintentional thing. Hope you can find it. If I go back to my lifetime comm badge and change the rest of these to silvery colours, and then go back to Odyssey 2. Yes, now that's changed. That's currently not a changeable colour, which is very interesting. Although it is one that we can modify individually. So if I dream under this colour here, so if I wanted that to be bright gold as well. There we go. So that is modifiable like that. If I have that as silvery colour, it's more in kin with the Voyager era. So along with that, I discovered that under arm attached left and right, we have Odyssey Tactical, which give us some little arm pockets, which we can also colour up. Let's have them red to match. There we go. And also beyond that, we have hip attach Odyssey Tactical, which again we can colour up, and we'll have those as red. And you can use these, as you can see, on any Odyssey variant, and I suspect, yep, any costume options you like. Even on top of the panels and pockets, default trousers. So yeah, you can go wild with those. Let's put that back to... So we now set these all to Odyssey Tactical, we can see how it's supposed to look. So, belt. Odyssey Tactical. Lower, Odyssey Tactical. Feet, Odyssey Tactical. Odyssey Tactical. So let's have... Just sort the belt out again quickly. There we go. Feet, we'll have those go black. Fantastic. And then we have a very quick, obviously tactical, set up with full tactical. Combat is gone. Not entirely sure whether these combat badges come from the dress or the tactical or one from each, but there they are. There we go. So that's a look at the Odyssey uniforms. And there we have it in the light of day. Oh, well, I find something that's a bit brighter than the inside of the tailor. Here's a nice bright spot. Or not. Why are there no bright areas on? Ooh, hello, another space dock. Aha, there's one. There we go. Light is in that general direction. So there we have it. And here we are on the KDF tailor with my science Klingon character. So we can see we have the Bortescue Warrior as a standard new appearance option. I presume the same is applied to the Odyssey in the Federation's side. But I'm going to go do some quick modifications just to show you what we have available. First of all, we actually have a Bortescue sash, which doesn't automatically equip for some bonkers reason. So on the top, we have the arms that we can change separately, which we'll put as black. The body we can change, we'll put that as black. Then we have those lines there, which we'll have as D12 blue. And, oh, just this bit on the back here. There's some goldy stuff we can have. So we'll have that as... what's the difference between that gold and that gold? That one's, it was a slightly brighter, as far as I can tell, so we'll have that. Then we have the sash, which has the main body colour, which we'll put to black here, and the outer straps, which we'll put to D12 blue. Her hands, they're just standard. Arm attaches, I'm pretty sure, just the key options. Shoulder pads, we have the Bortescue Warrior. So we'll have blue on those. Now, like I pointed out with the Odyssey belt, these pads are actually very dark, as is most of these blue straps. So even putting them on the brightest of colours is somewhat dim, which is a bit of a shame. And we have some nice gold band that we can stick on the edges of these, as we are a level 50 Lieutenant General character. The collar option we have here, Bortescue Warrior. Again, we'll have this central bit as D12, very dark blue. And that will go to... ooh, that's quite a thick band of gold there. Chest gear is just the kit options. Wrist attached left, we have the Bortescue Warrior gauntlets. That main body we'll have black. That extra bit there can go to our very dark blue. And those can go to gold. Interesting that bit in the front there doesn't get changed. Are they affected by... nope. That's affected by that banding. Okay, that's a little interesting. But we can live with that. You have blue and gold. Back we have... well, that's standard spine armour. Just because... I think things look better with spine armour. So we'll have... gold trim and blue middle. Then under the pants type we have our Bortescue trousers, which are very intricately detailed on the whole actually. So we'll have that bit can go blue, the main body can go to black, the sort of little built-in belt there can go to blue, and then we can have some gold trim. We also have the Bortescue Warrior belt, which we'll have black strap for, and then a gold buckle at the front because we're level 50. Ooh, that's lots of blue around the back. Uh-huh. Might be better to have that as black then, just have... oh, that's better. Do you want the straps blue or that body section blue? We'll leave that like that. Having all this stuff around the front does really look nice, all the intricate detail they've gone into that. And you also have the Borski Warrior boots, which, oops, will have the main body as black. One thing I really like is the ability to zoom in on the bottom half rather than just the top half. That bit can go to the dark blue. That bit will have blue as well, and then we have some more gold trim. I'm not entirely sure. I think that's around the back here, these little buckles. There we go. So that is the Borski uniform. Again, if you are a 200-day veteran subscriber, we also have the Borski long, which just adds a bit more to the bottom of it like that. Do it from the back, Borski and long. To be honest, looks very nice in comparison to how the Odyssey long works. So we will be taking that. And there we have it. Let's rename that to Borski. And we are done. Step out into the light. And we can... You really can't tell the... I've got most of that blue there, which is a bit of a shame. Let's face the light. Those shoulders are the brightest blue you can possibly choose, and that is still very black, which is something of a disappointment, really. Again, like the belt for the Odyssey, I'm hoping that that's just a thing that needs tweaking rather than an intended design aspect, but we'll have to live with it if it is. Likewise with the Odyssey stuff, there are three Borski options in the Fleet Tailor now. Unfortunately, I've been unable to secure a fleet invite here on Tribble to a KDF fleet. In fact, I'm not even sure if there is a KDF fleet here on Tribble. So I am regrettably unable to demonstrate those. However, they will be on holodeck in the fullness of time. Each of them costs slightly less than one third of the current price, according to the dev information I've seen on the forums. So I suspect it's probably perhaps one dilithium down just to account for rounding errors. But I'd be very intrigued to see what they look like. And I do indeed have them unlocked on one of my characters already, so I can check them out. Again, if you already own the standard Borski uniform, that will be completely free when it comes to holodeck. All you have to do is visit the Fleet Tailor and click buy on this item that costs nothing. If you are no longer a member of a fleet, that could be a problem. However, you can just get a fleet map invite. You don't even have to join the fleet. Now, the other reason we are here is because there's been a brand new patch to do with crafting. These schools are now in alphabetical order rather than level order, and since then I've also done some work in upgrading the cannons. And that's level 5, those are all level 2, because actually level 2 is very easy to get to. Now, unless they've changed these levels, which I don't think they have from looking at the overview list, these all look the same as they were before, I will now pop on screen a little annotation, which will show you the levels up to level 6, which is as far as I'm able to get cannons. And as you can see, you do need an awful lot of XP to get up to this point. So you now see your overall level at the top here. And what's going on? These are all still as they were. You now have an option here to show high level. So anything that you cannot craft yet because it's higher than your level is now hidden by default. Or you can now make them appear. And they appear at the top, so these actually appear to now be ordered by level. Yes, they are, that's quite nice. Big thing to note, these dilithium costs have been slashed. These Icelandic circuitries were 5,000 dilithium each, they're now only 1,000. And these Icelandic chips were 15,000, they're now only 5,000 each. This means that the cost of a Mark 12 weapon has come down from 20,000 dilithium to a much more reasonable 6,000 dilithium. Again, you need to get level 10 to be attacking those. That's going to take a while to get to. But at the end of the day, that's a lot better. Again, the devs have said these are not necessarily the final values, but they are much closer to what the final values will be. Now, one other thing that's happened is they've added the ability to turn in the old data samples and the like for new commodities in batches of more than one. Specifically in batches of up to 100. So let's take these out of my account bank, because I've copied myself onto Tribble a couple of times to get myself some more data samples, because quite simply I've run out of these Z particles in my attempt at getting myself some Mark 8 gear. Because you can get Mark 6 gear from level 0 without any problems. Level 8 requires these rare components, which require to use these, and they require level 5 in the crafting school to make them, which is a bit of a pain. However, these are tradable. You can trade them on the exchange, no doubt you can buy them on the exchange, and no doubt you can make a Mark 8 item from level 0. Indeed, you could probably do the same with Mark 10 and onwards. So having got those, we can now turn these in. This still looks the same, says one each, but we can now buy 28 at a go and get a bunch of stuff, which makes the whole process much nicer. Just go through these. It does mean you can't actually spam through them, which I did last time, but it does somewhat reduce the need to spam through them. And there we go. So we now have 14 Z particles. Which, if we go back to our R&D system in the cannons, we're looking at what these plasma compressors. There they are, because they're now at the top here. Each of these requires 5 Z particles. So that means with 14 Z particles, we can make 2. These beta shotgun particles, we only need 3 of, so we can. That's not going to be an issue. Firing sequences require 3 Z particles and 2 rubidium, so we can make one of those on top of a plasma compressor. Okie dokie. So if we actually go, what do we need to make some stuff? So cannon console, I think Mark 10 requires dilithium. No, Mark 10 we can do off the bat as well. So we need 2 firing sequences and 2 plasma compressors. We're not going to make, well, we already have 1 plasma compressor though, so we can make a Mark 10 item. That's nice. Mark 11, however, is dilithium. So that's not going to happen. So that's 1000 dilithium for a Mark 11, and Mark 12 is 6000. Which, at the end of the day, isn't that bad a cost, all told. So we're going to go for a Mark 10 phaser relay, which requires 2 firing sequences and 2 plasma compressors. So we have 1 plasma compressor already. So let's make a second one. Riasa will do fine. Now, they've also added these additional R&D holograms. These are additional duty officers that have no active roster abilities and no traits for duty officer system, but will allow you to make just about anything in the R&D system. You are indeed encouraged to discard these if you have better duty officers already. If you don't, then they're very helpful to make things go. But we'll stick with Riasa for now, because she's better. Still not got any catalysts, so we have a 63% chance of going for standard success and receiving 1 plasma compressor, or a 37% chance of going critical and getting ourselves 3. So they've added these in, which tell you what's going on much nicer. So, that's going to require 5 of our Z particles, 3 of our beta tachyon particles, and it's going to take 5 seconds. And off we go. Standard success, we have 1 more of those. We also need 2 of these firing sequences. So, again, same success rates and like different requirements. We can actually make 3 doing this, but we only need to have 2. There's 1, I know my luck, this one will now go critical and make us three more, but I won't complain too bitterly if that does happen. There we go. Nope, just the two are standard. Fine. So we can now go back into here, back to our cannon console, back up to phaser relay, mark 10 as it turns out. 10 of 10 is again our best option here. So we'll stick with 10 of 10, not sure that's male or female. Requires the rest of these junk. We're going to have a 51% chance of just getting a bog standard mark 10 phaser relay. 43% chance of getting an uncommon one. 6% chance of getting a rare one, and not a single chance at all of getting a very rare one. So this is partly because we're only level 5 in the cannon school, and we're doing this quite early. However, the XP earned doesn't get changed by whatever that is, so as we're only after the XP, not the item, that doesn't matter. And I have to wait 3 hours or pay 2,700 lithium to get that to complete. As this is Tribble and lithium is available freely, we're just going to hit finish now. And we're going to get a uncommon one. And our 1,800 XP, which pushes us nicely towards level 6. So yeah, that's the updates to crafting. We don't have enough of these to make any more rare components. We didn't get any back, so that's the end of that game. These other schools have all been updated, and under the engineering school, have a few new special items. The Aegis Hyper Impulse Engines have been added here, and they have indeed been upgraded. And not going to tell us about them. Oh, there we go. So the defense boost, which was I believe the two-piece set from Aegis, has now been baked into the engines. These are also now Mark 12s, before they stopped at level 10. This means they're now much better for. We also have the ultra rare version, which is... doesn't appear to have any difference in stats at this point. Not sure if there's something we're missing there, but that's fine. That would award you 12,000 engineering XP. However, in order to do that, you have to be level 15 already. Likewise, we have the conductive RCS accelerator, which will give us turn rate boost, that's the standard RCS accelerator, sorry, and when you are healed, that's a hull heal, you also receive damage reduction to shields, additional turn rate, and for that lasts for 15 seconds and can be activated once every 30 seconds. Which is a fairly handy thing to have on the whole, especially if you're someone that does an awful lot of hull healing. Now, similarly, in the science school we have the Aegis Deflector Array, which has also been buffed up from the standard Aegis. Again, has the ultra rare variant. Ah, it comes with a SSD mod, which is subspace decompiler. So that comes with an extra modifier. What about the Aegis Hyperimpulse engines? No more modifier there, so they're actually missing something still. And also we have the Science Console Exotic Particle Field Generator, which gives obviously boosted particle generators, plus 20% maximum shield capacity. That's very handy. And also when your shields are healed, you'll gain plus 10 weapon power for 15 seconds, which is, again, something pretty handy if you do a lot of shield healing. Obviously the ultra rare version is slightly stronger. Under shields, we have the Aegis Covariant Shield Array. Again, the three-piece bonus of the adaptive energy thingamabobby that adapts your shield resistance to energy types has been now baked in to the Aegis Covariant Shield Array. Likewise, it's received a bit of a buff. A lot of people, and to be honest, I am skeptical about this because of elite adaptive fleet shields. Elite adaptive fleet shields have a guaranteed adaptation to incoming energy damage, and can stack up to 10 times per energy type. The Aegis has a chance to increase resistance and stacks up to 5 times per energy type. So unless that's a pretty high chance and or a much higher defense per stack, that's probably going to be inferior. However, you also have to be aware of the 2 and 3 piece bonuses, which are energy negation and energy feedback conductor. Energy negation will allow you, actually, I've said a better thought. One big important thing about the Aegis set is if you have a current set, it should have been automatically upgraded to the new set. Which means I don't have to remember all that stuff off the top of my head, because somewhere in here I have a set already. So energy negation. Every 30 seconds, you'll gain a buff. Next time you are hit by an energy damage after receiving that buff, you'll receive 0 damage for 0.1 of a second, i.e. the next incoming hit. If you're hit by an awful lot of stuff, you might be able to get away with 1 or 2, but that's probably about it. The third energy feedback conductor is a very interesting active ability. When you activate it, you'll see plus 100 energy damage resistance, reduces damages by 30%. On top of that, when you receive energy damage, you receive a plus 2% bonus energy damage, which lasts for up to 10 stacks, you're not 20% bonus energy damage. And that lasts, I think, for the duration of the ability. So what we're going to do now, actually, is just because we can, we're going to take the Aegis set, and we're going to take my current ship, which is the Heart of Gold M Fleet Patrol Escort Refit. This is obviously the ship I was using when I transferred to Tribble. We can do that, and we are going to beam to space and take a look. As far as I'm aware, the visual appearance has not been modified, and I'll be able to confirm that momentarily. Yeah, that's still the same. Not the best of looks on this patrol escort refit. Vectors, not too bad. Engines, I presume, are the standard, yes. But the shield doesn't look particularly effective on here. Unless I'm really missing something. Oops, wrong one, shield. Disable. Yeah, that's quite a subtle for the Aegis. Only more obvious than that. Now all I have to do is find that ability on my power tray. Or it's not there. Okay, we'll find it in here then. Power tray is completely mucked up, but that's purely because of the transfer to Tribble from holodeck, not something that you should need to worry about for the Season 9.5 launch. Huh. Where is it? Ah, there it is. That's a feedback pulse icon. It might explain why I missed it before. Shield strength. No, I did. It's just not there. Okay, so when we do that, that's just the feedback pulse animation at the moment. Hopefully, that's not final. Hopefully, that's just a placeholder for it. But yeah. Let's go to a ship that looks a bit cooler on. Got it pretty cool here. So now we have an Avenger. Let's bring the Oh, they got rid of the icon on it, haven't they? Gem had eyes. Aegis, there it is. Yeah, you can see all the extra lines have been added to it. Ooh, that's a bit weird there. Ah, there's a little grill in the hull. That's been somewhat adversely affected by it. Oh, we haven't put engines crossing, have we? That'll help. So there we are. That is the latest update to crafting here on the Tribble server, as well as a quick look at the new uniform options that they've added as part of season 9.5. My name has been P52 Smith. Thank you very much for watching, and goodbye.